The Technological System by Jacques Ellul. 1. People are not machines, but in every opportunity where they are allowed to behave like machines, they will so behave. 2. 25 years ago, I arrived at the notion of the technological society, but now, that stage is past. 3. The industrial society. This term is very widespread, but I find it inadequate. 4. Present-day society is still industrial, but that is not its essence. 5. At one time, technology and machine industry were connected, but for more than half a century now, a gap has widened between them. Industrialism developed a centralized, hierarchical system, with a linear growth, a division of labor, and a separation between the means and the ends. Mechanization created additional jobs and made human work more draining. It operated by means of steady reproduction, developing masses of men and integrating them in the industrialization. 6. Modern technology, however, contradicts each of those different points. If allowed to act, it leads to decentralization and flexibility. It does away with the hierarchy and the division of labor. It particularly has to bridge the gap between implementation and management. It presupposes a polyvalent and nonlinear growth. It reintegrates the ends into the means. It cuts down on labor and thus on the costs of labor. The value factor is no longer human work but scientific invention and technological innovation. Consequently, we can no longer apply Marx's analysis, which states that the economic totality is based on the surplus value produced by the salaried labor of the worker. 7. The industrial system is a closed, repetitive world, with a linear revolution. The technological system is inevitably open, non-repetitive, with a polyvalent evolution. It can proceed only by the universal development of mankind, and that development is absolutely necessary for the development of the technological system. We are thus confronted with an ensemble that is totally different from any that has ever existed before. 8. Technology, conceived in terms of its automation, its chemical transformation of the world, its economy of energy, its cybernation, its data processing, its biological intervention, and its indefinite output of nuclear energy, has little to do with the old industrial mechanization. 9. Technology is power, made up of instruments of power, hence producing phenomena and structures of power, that is, of domination. 10. Terrain, in contrast to Bell, hesitates about a qualifying term. Thus, he speaks of a programmed society. In this case, I am far more in agreement. For he thereby joins the overall outlook of those people for whom the new thing about our society is the organization. He sharply distinguishes between the primary, capitalist, era of industrialization and our era. He qualifies this new society in terms of three features. 1. The emergence of new social classes, technicians, bureaucrats, efficiency experts. 2. The new trend of business, which is now based on organization and no longer on the relationship between economic power and productive labor. 3. Spare time activities. All three characteristics boil down to a reduction and to the necessities of the technological system, which, as Turing realizes, transforms the social struggles themselves. They are becoming more technological and are no longer subject to a takeover by the proletariat. Turing adds one more essential feature of post-industrial society: the importance of the student movement with its deep contestation, its challenge, and its political weakness. But, as I have tried to show in my studies on revolution, I regard this feature as episodic and contingent. 11. What triggers consumption? Advertising, that is to say, the technologies of advertising. What is it that demands greater consumption? Mass production, which is possible only because of technology. What are we given to consume? Technological objects, because they are the things that are produced most. Hence, the consumer society, in all its aspects, is primarily characterized by various technologies. 12. Spectacle is a complete way of life. Consumption is a spectacle, so are political activity and leisure and work and family life and revolution. Modern man watches everything as a spectator. Everything is supplied to him as a spectacle, including the things he believes he is most deeply contributing to or participating in. 13. Technological activity is, by nature, spectacular, excluding all internal reality. Technological activity is what waters down all serious things, since no action can be performed any longer unless by way of technologies. 14. Z. Buzzinski, Between Two Ages, America's Role in the Technotronicy Era, 1970, also figured he could add something absolutely new by coining the term, technotronic. He lists a number of differences between industrial and technotronic society. In industrial society, the machine plays the essential role. The dominant social problems are unemployment and employment. Teaching is done through human relations. The ruling class is plutocratic. The university is an ivory tower isolated from reality. Reading favors a conceptual thinking proper to ideologies. Political conflicts are intrinsic. The masses are organized into trade unions. Economic power is personalized. Wealth is the object of activity. 15. Technotronic is a portmanteau word combining technical and electronic. Come now. Isn't electronics technological? Does the word add anything to the early definitions of technology? Once again, technology equals the machine plus industry. Fine, then there is something new according to the famous definition. In a machine, there are material parts that move. Electronics operates with no moving material parts. Granted. But if the computer is not a machine in the normal sense, then in what way is it not the product of a certain number of technologies? In what way is it not integrated in a technological system? There is no reason to distinguish between technology and electronics. 16. Man can no longer be a subject. 4. The system implies that, at least in regard to itself, man must always be treated as an object. Today, this phenomenon is far more important than the renowned Marxist interpretation of commodity. 17. Nothing can have an intrinsic sense, it is given meaning only by technological application. Nothing can lay claim to action, it is acted upon by technological process. Nothing can regard itself as autonomous, it is the technological system that is autonomous, as we shall demonstrate. 18. No technician claims to be ruling society. There is no need to regard technicians as technocrats or to believe that a class of that type actually exists. 19. Colin Clark's classification is replaced by a different one, at the bottom, the unqualified functionals, then the functional operators, and at the top, the rulers, researchers, conceivers, with perhaps a fourth sector for the activities of operational research. In other words, the social distribution is, already, less and less in terms of activities applied to the economy, and more in keeping with the technological capacity. 20. The era of clerks, and these clerks are the decision makers in all domains because they have the knowledge and use of the technologies. Like it or not, and Hetman shows this so well, the experts, the specialists of diverse technologies are to be found everywhere, from business to administration, from government to agriculture. They form the true grid of society, the network holding the various pieces together. It is the technological coherence that now makes up the social coherence. But this is not a technocracy in the true sense of the word. 21. The discovery of the technological system normally seems like an attack against technology, a criticism of technicity per se. Any shedding of light on the technological structure is always received by technologists and intellectuals as an indictment of that structure, even if absolutely no value judgment has been expressed. 22. Baudrillard. When watching TV, we are incapable of knowing that this miracle is a long social process of production, which leads to our consumption of images. for technology wipes away the very principle, social, reality. Everything that is social has moved to an abstract level, with the strange phenomenon of an acute awareness of non-reality, for example, the passion for politics, and an unawareness of reality, for example, technology. 23. It is technology that hides itself. Of course, this is not deliberate. There is no anthropomorphism here, behind that luminous play of appearances. 24. In reality, we must not confuse the technological system and the technological society. The system exists in all its rigor, but it exists within the society, living in and off the society and grafted upon it. 25. The machine works because of natural products, but it does not transform nature into a machine. Society too is a natural product. At a certain level, culture and nature overlap, forming society, in a totality that becomes a nature for man. And into this complex comes a foreign body, intrusive and unreplaceable, the technological system. It does not turn society into a machine. It fashions society in terms of its necessities. It uses society as an underpinning. It transforms certain of society's structures. But there is always something unpredictable, incoherent, and irreducible in the social body. A society is made up of multiple systems, multiple types, multiple patterns, on different levels. Saying that technology is the determining factor of this society does not mean it is the only factor. Above all, society is made up of people, and the system, in its abstraction, seems to ignore that. It is only at an extreme point that we can view the society and the system as one and the same. But nobody can seriously maintain that this extreme has been reached. 26. The technological society is one in which a technological system has been installed. 27. To achieve total liberty, exemption, and independence from natural as well as moral or social constraints, man must be in that state of perfect de-individualization. 28. All utopians of the past, without a single exception, have presented society exactly as a mega machine. 29. For him, consumption is neither a material practice nor a phenomenology of abundance. It is not defined by food and the like. It is the virtual totality of all the objects and messages now organized in a more or less coherent discourse. Consumption is an activity of systematic manipulation of signs. 30. This society, in which technology has become dominant, is the first to have the concept of technology. 31. Originally, it seems, people spoke of technique, which, consistent with its etymology, meant a certain manner of doing something, a process or ensemble of processes. Diderot thus speaks of the technique proper to each painter. But rapidly, as the machine and its industrial application came to dominate, technique, and then technology in English, began to designate the processes of constructing and exploiting machines. People now more frequently employed the plural. These were then studied by a science called technology in French and technology in English. While English uses technology for both the science and its object of study, French distinguishes respectively between technology and technique. Trans. Note. This science consists in describing and analyzing these techniques, French, that is technologies, English, in tracing their history and investigating ways of improving them. At the end of the 19th century, the science of technology was divided into five branches, which is quite indicative of what was then known as technique, or technology. These five branches were raw materials, processes and machines bearing upon the home, plus clothes and food, hygiene and health, light and heat, tools and instruments. 32. Scientists soon distinguished between instruments and energy sources. The classification of technologies was now by tools and instruments, machines, apparatuses. Tools and instruments are material systems for increasing the efficiency of human action. Notably, they give man access to phenomena with an intensity that is too weak to act directly upon the senses, measuring instruments, or else they multiply the intensity of his efforts. From a technological viewpoint, these tools and instruments have the characteristic of being directly operated by man. Machines are material systems replacing man for actions he cannot perform himself, most often because they require too much energy. Finally, the ambiguous term apparatus designates both complex instruments and machines using a small amount of energy. Naturally, each area combines several tools, machines, and instruments in order to perform an operation correctly. Thus, the division of labor multiplies the number of technologies, which themselves produce machines. 33. Hence, technology was seen no longer as a parceling operation, but as a set of inanimate or exceptionally animate beings, organized to replace man in performing a set of operations defined by man. Louis Cufignal, THOR DE LEFICACIT DE L'ACTION. Technology thus has two new features. It no longer relates to just an aspect, an action, but to a whole, a set, an ensemble. It refers above all to machines that tend to replace man. And among these machines, one distinguishes those that furnish energy, those that utilize energy, power machines replacing man in his processing of material, and those involved in information, operational machines replacing man in his operations of creating, transforming, or transmitting information. On this level, technology scarcely refers to industrial operations. 34. The stages of technology are readily compared to the stages of industrial growth. These stages are dictated by energy production. Observers thus speak of the first industrial revolution, characterized by the use of coal as a power source, and by the machines built to use coal. Then came a second industrial revolution, characterized by electricity. The third one causes some wavering, the use of atomic energy. But for several years now, people have been speaking of a fourth industrial revolution, the one launched by the computer. It is obvious that we are now switching gears, for this is no longer a change or advance in power sources. The dominant factor is no longer a growth of potential or exploited energy, but rather an apparatus of organization, information, memorization, and preparation for decision-making, to replace man in a huge number of intellectual operations. 35. We can see that all the above stages are linked to the use of machines and specific technologies. But technology is then viewed as a reality that is independent of more or less improved practices and of machines. Technology as a whole has a general character in relation to individual technologies, but it does not leave the area of machine application. Nevertheless, a new meaning soon appeared. It became more and more obvious that these technologies and machines had vast consequences for human behavior and societal organization. People now began speaking of the technological society, Georges Friedman, Société Technocène. Using technology in a wider sense, they began studying the machine not only in itself, but also in its relations to man and society. We will not examine here this social science of technology studied as the industrial society. 36. Nevertheless, at that time 20 years ago, the term technology was limited to the strict meaning of a scientific study of technological processes with no reference to sociological dimensions. For the latter, people spoke of a sociology of the machine or of technology. However, a new concept was already emerging. On the one hand, technology could apparently be defined very broadly in terms of what had implicitly been its overriding feature since its origins, efficiency. People could now say that technology was the ensemble of the absolutely most efficient means at a given moment. This allowed unhooking technology from the machine. For there were so many other technologies than those coupled to machines, for instance, sport technologies. Moreover, this definition had a great advantage. It reminded us that technology was made up of means, or means, but that we could focus only on those regarded as the most efficient at any moment, because that was the very criterion of choice and progress in the technologies. In other words, wherever there is research and application of new means as a criterion of efficiency, one can say that there is a technology. The latter is not defined by the instruments used or by some area of action, clothing, transportation, etc. There are perfectly abstract technologies, for example, speed reading. Yet the same word was employed to designate the parcellary, mechanical technologies and technology in that latter sense. 37. Lionel Robbins, for example, The Sociological Imagination, p. 80, rightly says, it is not an exaggeration to say that, at the present day, one of the main dangers of civilization arises from the inability of minds trained in the natural sciences to perceive the difference between the economic and the technical. 38. So long as we fail to study the technological phenomenon beyond its economic implications and the problems of the economic system and class struggle, we are doomed to ignorance of contemporary society, and hence, impotence for any revolutionary action. 39. Economic progress and technization are not synonymous. Technization does not have an economic aspect from the very outset. Today, if there really is a potential and debated kinship between technological and economic growth, there is no kinship whatsoever between technological growth and economic development, as we shall see. 40. There is a world of difference between the laboratory discovery of a technology and its universal application. 41. It is not the dangers in the growth of those technologies that frighten me, but rather the childishness of the authors who believe that these technologies are already here and that tomorrow's world is today's laboratory. To speak of machine that lives and thinks, or even reproduces itself is infantile anthropocentrism, von Neumann. 42. New Age Thinking and Technology, Karl Reich, technology itself produces consciousness, EA, which is that of man as a free and spiritual adult. Hippies everywhere. It suffices if the system of values changes, if psychological behavior is transformed, if the way of life is transformed, and poof! Technology has no more power. The triumph of long hair and bell bottoms, proclaims Reich, guarantees our mastership of technology, for the choice of a lifestyle is an act of transcendence of the machine, an act of independence, a declaration of independence. We are entering a new age of man. 43. Technology as an environment. 44. People generally conceive of technology as a means of action allowing man to do what he was unable to achieve by his own means. That is true, of course. But it is much more important to consider that these means are a mediation between man and his natural environment. This mediation can be either passive or active, clothing, dwellings, technological products are screens placed between the body and the surrounding environment. 45. As Simondon emphasizes, concretization gives the technological object an intermediary place between the natural object and the scientific representation of the abstract, that is primitive technological object, which is a far cry from constituting a natural system. It is the translation into matter of a set of scientific notions and principles that are separate from one another. On the other hand, the concrete, that is evolved technological object approaches the existential mode of natural objects. It tends towards inner coherence, towards closure of the system of causes and effects. Furthermore, it incorporates a part of the natural world, which is involved as a condition of functioning. 46. It has often been said that work is what makes the human being the mediator between nature and mankind as a species. If this is true, then technological work creates for itself the most immense set of mediations imaginable because the work is incorporated and lasting. 47. Through technological activity, man creates mediations, and these mediations can be detached from the individual who produces them and conceives them. The individual expresses himself in them but does not adhere to them. The machine is a kind of impersonalness, which allows it to become another man's instrument. The human reality that it crystallizes within itself is alienable precisely for being detachable. The technological object, conceived and constructed by man, is not limited to just creating a mediation between man and nature. It is a stable mixture of the human and the natural. It contains the human and the natural. It gives its human content a structure resembling that of natural objects. It can be inserted into the world of natural causes and effects in that human reality. The relation between man and nature is not merely experienced and practiced in an obscure fashion, it takes on a status of stability, of consistency, which makes it a reality having its own laws and its orderly permanence. Technological activity, by putting up the world of technological objects and universalizing the objective mediation between man and nature, reattaches man to nature with a far richer and more definite bond than that of the specific reaction of collective labor. 48. All those things are perfectly true. But we have to add that this mediation becomes exclusive of any other. There are no other relationships between man and nature. The whole set of complex and fragile bonds that man has patiently fashioned poetic, magic, mythical, symbolic bonds vanishes. 49. There is only the technological mediation, which imposes itself and becomes total. Technology then forms both a continuous screen and a generalized mode of involvement. Technology is in itself not only a means, but a universe of means in the original sense of universum, both exclusive and total. 50. Speaking about televised sports, he, Baudrillard, shows that they have an important function, participation. The participating athlete and the participating spectator each gets what he wants, the athlete, the pleasure of being on the tube, the spectator, the feeling of being part of a whole, in contact. They get what they're after, communion. Or rather that modern, aseptized form of communion, communication, contact. 51. Communion no longer passes through a symbolic support but through a technological support. It is in those terms that communion is communication. 52. Technology is the support of interhuman communion. 53. Technology has become a mediator. 54. Vast consequences. The first is that we are dealing with an autonomous mediation. 55. It is common knowledge that the most important thing is not so much the choice of a value as the possibility of a mediation between the value and the individual or the social body. Technology, as the sole mediator now recognized, actually escapes any system of values. 56. This allows technology to entirely escape the desired or supposed values. 57. The mediation by technology is essentially sterile and sterilizing, contrary to all previous systems of mediation, which were plurivocal, equivocal, unstable in their applications, and also deeply rooted in a rich and creative unconscious. 58. Not only does technology mediate between man and the natural environment and, to a second degree, between man and the technological environment, but it also mediates between men. People are more and more in contact with one another because of technological instruments, the telephone, and psychological technologies, pedagogy, human relations, group dynamism. 59. Artificial environment. He no longer lives in touch with the realities of the earth and the water, but with the realities of the instruments and objects forming the totality of his environment. He is now in an environment made of asphalt, iron, cement, glass, plastic, and so on. 60. The worker, for instance, no longer knows anything about the material he is working on. He only has to know the machines performing the necessary operations. And then soon, there is a second abstraction with automation. 61. When man finds himself in an environment that is becoming exclusively technological, the mode of savage thinking, which survives as such in man, becomes fairly useless. The savage mind is determined by the natural environment. 62. Symbolization, which helped man to survive in a hostile world, has become inadequate for the technological environment, in which it has no use. 63. Plan obsolescence. The invasion by the objects is accompanied by the scorn for those very same objects. 64. Things are made to be destroyed. Humans and weapons in Vietnam's war, bought to be discarded, multiplied in order to be eliminated. Objects are the object of our profound scorn. 65. But why is that? In reality, these objects have no value or importance whatsoever, they exist only as products of the technological mechanism. What characterizes this society is not the object but the means. It is not the invasion by the objects, but the multiplication of means ad infinitum. 66. Our universe is not a universe of objects, that it is not a system of objects, but a universe of means and a technological system. 67. The old, natural, environment is not really abandoned in favor of the new, technological, one. Rather, the new one permeates the old one, engulfs it, utilizes it, but in order to become the phagocyte, and disintegrates it like a cancerous tissue proliferating in an earlier non-cancerous one. The simplest visual example is the way the city world encroaches upon rural areas through the spread of the suburbs. 68. The well-known depletion of natural resources, which we shall come back to later, results not only from abuse by the technologies, but also from the very establishment of technology as man's new milieu. 69. Technology reduces a whole to simple units by analyzing it and generally compartmentalizing it. The tailor work method is a model example. 70. The wholes established by technology do not make us feel complete or satisfied, they are still experienced as splintered wholes. 71. But there's a rub. The old environment has not totally disappeared. We still have air and water. And even man cannot do without them as yet. This is essentially what causes the irrationality and the system crisis as we see it. 72. But obviously, we will never reach the old complexity of the natural environment, a complexity that we discover more and more as we destroy it. We cannot reach it because technology simplifies. 73. We do not exactly know the complexities of the ecosystem, reduced to a supporting role, that we are destroying. We discover them by the consequences of their disappearance. 74. The technological environment is in fact characterized by the growth of abstraction and controls. It is obvious that in such conditions, the technological environment scarcely favors spontaneity, creativity. 75. Without claiming that the technological environment is equivalent to an engine, the comparison is a good one. Only the artifact can enter this environment, for it is made in such a way as to fit in exactly. It is made for. Which cannot be said of any of the natural elements. Hence, the artificialness of the technological environment causes it to be absolutely exclusive. 76. It used to be nature that imposed its evolutionary rhythm upon us. Now it is technology. It used to be nature that determined certain social structures, Bodin's and Montesquieu's famous theory of climates. Now it is technology. It used to be nature that meted out the raw materials. Now the crux is the technological processing. It used to be nature that required man to establish fixed laws of relations between objects and himself, property. Now, the objects, emerging from a constantly renewing technological action, are no longer so important. What counts is know-how, which enables us to fit in precisely and find our places in the technological environment. 77. What modern linguistics really does is to reduce language in such a way as to make it fit neatly into this technological universe, trimmed down to an indispensable communication for the creation of the system. Language is losing its mystery, its magic, its incomprehensibility. It no longer expresses dreams. 78. Technization of language. 79. It is not useless to recall that the first satisfactory definition of technology that we find is by Max Weber, who sees it precisely as a means. The technique of an action refers to the means employed as opposed to the meaning or end to which the action is, in the last analysis, oriented. Rational technique is a choice of means which is consciously and systematically oriented to the experience and reflection of the actor, which consists at the highest level of rationality in scientific knowledge. The ultimate meaning of a concrete act may, seen in the total context of action, be of a technical order, that is, it may be significant only as a means in this broader context. Then the meaning of the concrete act, viewed from the larger context, lies in its technical function, and conversely, the means which are applied in order to accomplish this are its techniques. The presence of a technical question always means that there is some doubt over the choice of the most rational means to an end. 80. Hegel realized the beginning of that metamorphosis when he wrote, "The tool as such keeps back man's material annihilation, but in this respect it remains his activity. In the machine, man sublates this formal activity of his and lets it work fully for him. However, the deception he practices on nature takes its revenge on him. Whatever he wins from nature, the more he subjugates it, the lower he becomes himself. He may process nature by means of various machines, but he does not sublate the necessity of his labor. He merely puts off his labor, removes it from nature, and he does not erect himself as living upon nature as living. Instead, this negative livingness flees, and the labor that remains for him becomes more and more machine-like itself." 81. Technology as a determining factor. If research is so important, it is because it leads to technology and not to pure intellectual satisfaction. These current formulas point out that technology is the determinant factor in our society. 82. All the so-called decentralization efforts merely produce deconcentration, which actually intensifies the centralization. 83. The more important the state becomes, the less important the citizen, the theoretical bearer of political sovereignty. 84. Remarkably, the same is true of the traditional politician. The congressman, senator, even the government minister, have less and less real power. 85. The politician has a facade role, he provides the showy front, and he also assumes responsibility for a matter of which he has only very shallow knowledge. 86. What is the source of this double phenomenon? I believe that the reason for the system is technological growth. 87. In modern society, it is always because of technology that the jurisdiction of the state keeps expanding. 88. The politician can exercise no control in the multiplicity of services. He depends entirely on three kinds of people: experts, technicians, and administrators, themselves technicians, of organizing and implementing. These people alone have the knowledge and the means of action. 89. There are very few technicians who wish to have political power. 90. We are watching the birth of a technological state, which is anything but a technocracy. This new state has chiefly technological functions, a technological organization, and a rationalized system of decision making. 91. Historians know that a sudden increase of population occurs at certain periods without our being able to pinpoint any exact causes. In particular, we cannot resolve the following problem: is population growth the cause or the result of economic growth? Either side can be argued. In all likelihood, the two phenomena give rise to one another. Nevertheless, at the present time, the determining factor of production growth is indisputably the technological development. 92. Technology wipes out the ancient regulators: infant mortality, famine, etc., and we no longer believe what was a certain truth 20 years ago, namely, that the rise in the overall living standard and the wealth of food automatically cause a drop in the birth rate. The baby boom in the United States contradicts that earlier assumption. 93. I feel we can say that technology may not be the determining factor but a major determining factor in the interlinked phenomena. 94. The massive development of technology triggers a certain number of changes in the individual, especially by creating new needs that are in no way false or artificial, and in the society, which cannot maintain the same structures. Consider these two facts. Man cannot live and work in a technological society unless he receives a certain number of complementary satisfactions allowing him to overcome the drawbacks. Spare time activities, distractions, their organization, are not superfluous, they cannot be done away with for the sake of something more useful, they do not represent a true rise in the standard of living. They are thoroughly indispensable in making up for the uninteresting work, the deculturation caused by specialization, the nervous tension due to the excessive speed of all operations, the acceleration of progress requiring difficult readjustment. All these things, which are brought on by technological development, can be tolerated only if man finds a new level of compensations. 95. It seems that the more production rises, the more our society becomes technicized, and the more these needs grow in number and quality. 96. I submit that in our technological society, the forces of production are no longer the infrastructure. They have become a superstructure. That is to say, they can develop and keep advancing only if there is a social infrastructure of organization capable of both producing the research indispensable to such progress and receiving this progress into the social body. The mechanism of production is now conditioned by services. It is no longer the interior of the technological world, the determining factor. 97. As a second consequence, one could very cautiously cite a new aspect of the law of diminishing returns. We know that this law was formulated for agricultural output and is today judged incorrect. But it can, I feel, now be applied to industrial production. Let us say schematically that when technology is first applied to industrial output, the growth is in direct proportion to the technological progress. But the more this output increases, the more it requires a framework of multiple services. The technological progress then encompasses vaster and more complex ensembles, and only part of that progress can be directly applied to production. As we advance, the part applied to production diminishes proportionally. In other words, an increased output of useful goods requires greater technological strength applied to sectors that are not directly useful. Hence, the growth in production of useful goods tends to keep declining at a constant progression within a technological system. Of course, this notion of decreasing useful returns is valid only under two conditions: if we look at overall production, and if the country being studied is highly technicized. This phenomenon can be observed only at a very high production level. 98. Mistake has Toffler, who claims we are entering an era of total and constant change, which is a bit juvenile. 99. I have tried to show that technology is a realization, hence an achievement, hence an increase, of the spirit of power, which led to a polarization of man in respect to power. This is brilliantly taken up and demonstrated by Bertrand de Jouvenel, Arcady, when he meticulously studies the fact that modern wealth is the expression of the will to power. Technological progress is essentially a manifestation of human power, a chance for man to admire himself. The development of power was the goal, with greater comfort as a byproduct. Likewise, technological progress, for man, is a variant of the spirit of conquest, which is both satisfied and reinforced by technology. This spirit of conquest causes the division of man into producer and consumer and his obedience to the imperative of efficiency. What is interesting in Juvenal's study is not only his demonstration of the consequences of these well-known phenomena but also his insertion of them into economic theory. 100. Baudrillard shows to what extent the culture and education issuing from technology are the absolute reverse of the culture conceived as, 1, the heritage of works, thoughts, traditions, 2. The continuous dimension of theoretical and critical reflection, critical transcendence and symbolic function. 101. The crucial thing is that culture is no longer meant to endure. It is the rapid progression of technology that condemns culture to being the opposite of what it has always been. Now it is the immediate consumption of a technological product without substance. 102. As Baudrillard rightly notes, there is ultimately no difference between mass culture, which devises contents, and avant-garde creation, which manipulates forms. Both are determined by the functional imperative of technology that everything must always be up to date. 103. There have never been any egalitarian societies, and hierarchy was part of the general cultural universe. Only a few ineffective utopians could pretend to build an egalitarian society. 104. All this is a direct result of technological growth. Technology cannot put up with irrational discriminations or social structures based on beliefs. All inequality, all discrimination, for example racial, all particularism, are condemned by technology, for it reduces everything to commensurable and rational factors. 105. New forms of wealth have replaced what used to be capital, a job, retirement rights, a management or concession license, social security, hospitalization under a doctor's care. Those are the new forms of wealth representing relations to organizations. 106. What counts is not so much the money that an individual possesses, but rather the money that he can spend. And this depends on his technological capacity and his status. He is an engineer at Renault, a doctor of political economy, etc. So that status unites the condition of people in a socialist and in a capitalist society. Property is transformed into relations. Such is the new property based on the technological capacity, which guarantees status. 107. Self-management by the workers at the bottom is a dangerous utopia. 108. Observers habitually declare that a modern man has to be ready, because of the technologies, to change his profession 2 or 3 times in his life. But according to Montmelin's very judicious comment, there are no more professions, there are only jobs or activities. It is wrong to say that nowadays a worker has to change trades 2 or 3 times during his life. He does not change his trade, he does not have one. He therefore has to keep readjusting almost permanently. The most important measure to be taken in 1980 in the retraining of workers is to abolish the very idea of retraining. We would have to be so accustomed to training in industry that we should not think in terms of training and retraining, but only of training and more training. Contrary to what is often asserted, work is far from having lost its laboriousness because of technology. Quite the opposite. It seems that even after the era of the machine, whose effects on man are common knowledge, work has actually become even more laborious, more draining than before. 109. The computer has carried us from the civilization of experience to the civilization of knowledge. 110. The computer appeared when information, stored, written, became unusable. 111. With the computer, knowledge becomes a force of production, a decisive power in politics, though to the degree that all the economic and technological factors cohere in a rationally grasped whole. 112. The problem is now the conflict between that absolute rationality and what has hitherto constituted the person. That is the pivot of all present-day reflection, and, for a long time, it will remain the only philosophical issue. 113. Technology contained in itself that complete transformation of the relationship to reality. Baudrillard, La Société de Consommation, did an excellent job of showing this. It is remarkable to think that technology, which is often accused of materializing man, of chaining him to the material environment, and which does indeed center everything on activity in the material, derealizes everything, transforms everything into a sign of nothing to consume. nature has been rediscovered in the guise of a rustic sample, framed by the immense urban tissue, gridded and honeycombed in the form of open spaces, nature preserves, or as backdrops to weekend cottages. This rediscovery is actually a recycling of nature. That is to say, nature is no longer an original, specific presence, in symbolic opposition to the culture, but a model of simulation, a digest of signs of nature put back into circulation. 114. Technology, as a mediator and as the new environment, makes every reality other than itself abstract, remote, and devoid of content. In this gigantic transformation, how can we help but attribute once again the role of determining factor to technology? 115. Technology as a system. 116. By speaking of the technological system, I propose to take account of an important part of reality. 117. The technological system is not completed. It is not closed. It is not a system evolving by its own unique internal logic. 118. The technological system is formed by the existence of the technological phenomenon and by technological advance. I am using technological phenomenon in the sense that I gave it in the technological society, distinguishing it from technological operation, which has always existed throughout history. It is technology that works its own change. It has what Juvenal calls a permanent revolution of processes. Progression is a part of the object itself. It is constitutive to the object. As we have said, there is no technology without progression. Technological progress is not evolving technology. It is not technological objects that change because they are improved. It is not an adding up of influences on those machines or those organizations that impels them to adjust. Technology has as a specific given, the feature that it requires its own transformation for itself. From the very instant that it existed in its modern reality, it produced the phenomenon of progression. The progress with which we are imbued and whose ideology inspires all our judgments is a direct result of technology. It is not technology progressing, it is a new and independent reality. It is the conjunction of the technological phenomenon and technological progress that constitutes the technological system. Hence, there are traits, regulations, laws, if one can still phrase it thus, in both. Technological progress takes place in a certain way and offers peculiarities distinguishing it from other types of evolution. Economic growth or cultural development does not happen along the same lines as technological progression. Therefore, the technological system is characterized by a set of specific traits that distinguish it from other verifiable systems. As for the singularity of this system, it reveals itself in the very circumstance that a technological factor always preferentially joins with another technological factor. An attraction exists between them, and it is clearly due not to the nature of either factor but to their belonging to the same system. Hence, the associations with external factors, depending on other systems, political, economic, ideological, are certainly not excluded, but they are always secondary. 119. And when mechanization is introduced into offices, it is a kind of spearhead launched in that direction by the technological system. Administration is then modified. Above all, it loses its determining character, and is now determined by the new apparatus. Unity is achieved not so much in the earlier framework, government/administration, but by means of the correlations between the diverse technologies. Thus there are no scattered technological factors, integrated into various social, political, economic contexts, which affect organizational principles, their unity, etc. Quite the reverse. There is a technological system having various modalities of intervention and attaching to itself every fragment of the human or social reality, which operation, moreover, removes that fragment from the tissue it was a part of. Hence, every technological factor, associated with the others, forms a more or less coherent and doubtlessly rigorous whole. The coherence is internal but not necessarily evident. 120. Technology exists only because there are human beings participating in it, making it function, inventing, choosing. To claim we can examine technology without regarding the chance elements, the irregularities produced by man, means proceeding to an illegitimate and, moreover, impossible abstraction. The technological system is purely imaginary, we never see it. What we see, what we encounter, are men using the instruments. Ultimately, technology does not exist. There are products, there are machines, there are methods. But it is artificial to view them together. Lefebvre wants to show that there are plural technologies, diverse, mutually unrelated, and plural technological objects, scattered, dispersed, with very divergent finalities, and never concerning the same environments. There is thus a collection, an addition, but no system. 121. I realize that by analyzing the technological system as an object in itself, without considering mankind or groups, I am going counter to one of the chief trends in present-day sociology. Weber is reproached for studying bureaucracy as a system, setting forth its traits and operating laws. His detractors point out that it is the officials, the clerks that count, and that, ultimately, no concrete investigation reveals any of the laws and principles forwarded by Weber. Instead, we find human relationships, actions and reactions of groups and individuals, dysfunctions, choices, and initiatives. 122. That, and nothing else, is the verifiable reality of an administration. That is man in relation to what is known as technology. It is he who, in the final analysis, is called upon to act and to choose. Even if there is a certain reality of technology, it is erroneous to claim we can analyze it by disregarding the human presence. And yet, although I am familiar with this objection and acknowledge its full accuracy, such an analysis is precisely what I have attempted here. And my reasons are twofold. 123. We know that from his very origins, man has tried to establish a system of nature. He has striven for both a system of relations, and an explanatory system. He has often gone awry, with magical or metaphysical explanations and correspondences, but each time, one system replaced another, until he formulated a system of rational relationships that are called scientific. This is precisely the same labor that we have attempted here. We do not claim that our description of the technological system is scientific or decisive, but only that this is an indispensable first step, without which nothing can be done toward comprehending man's new universe. 124. In other words, by studying the technological system, I appear to be disregarding man. But in fact, I am showing the canvas on which action, refusal, angst, approval, perception, etc. take place. And without knowing that canvas, I could not understand those experiences and perceptions. 125. I do not offer what takes place, what is, but what man modifies, accelerates, disturbs, etc. 126. Nonetheless, there is a further error to be avoided here. We should not believe that if technology is considered in this way, it is an object, or that, in relation to technology, man is a subject. Yet that is what we hear all the time. After all, technology merely supplies things, and man does whatever he likes with them. Thus, what we hear all the time, everything depends on their good or bad use. Remarkably, moreover, the very same people declare that the technological system does not exist as such and that there are only technological objects. In point of fact, however, those objects are not scattered and unrelated, they are included in a system. Furthermore, man, who is to act upon this system, who is to use these technological objects, is not a man per se, an absolute subject either. He himself is incorporated in a technological society. 127. We have to zero in on this current opinion. First of all, it belongs to the man in the street, who, of course, does not perceive a technological ensemble. He thinks he is dealing with his car, his TV, his modern accounting register, the IBM machine, and the airplane. Separate elements, distinct uses, an absence of reflection on their coherence and continuity. But this attitude results just as much from specialization. Each sector develops independently of the others, in appearance. Each of us is immersed in a separate technological domain. Each man knows his professional technology, and only that. He is aware, theoretically, that other technologies exist side by side with his, but he does not see the inner coherence of the sectors, and he can dream about all those vast and free fields which are ruled by independence and imagination, his own field being that of rigor, efficiency, and enslavement. Last but not least, among intellectuals, this attitude results from a systematic refusal to consider this reality. If technology is truly a system, then freedom of thought is a mere decoy, man's sovereignty is threatened, etc. And since this cannot be, then technology cannot possibly be a system. 128. Those intellectuals maintain the image of an intact society, and an intact human being, a society whose structures are comparable to those of the past, not the same, to be sure, whose groups, culture, work are subject to the same principles and the same analyses, though we perceive the differences, to be sure. Society, the same old society, is thought of as consisting, still, of classes, with similar class relationships, and obeying the same old dialectics. 129. It is very hard to accept that we live in a society having no common measure with earlier societies, and that the experiences and thoughts of our ancestors are no longer of any use to us. 130. We have to regard not so much the change of older frameworks as the appearance of a new environment, every particular technology, for each one can be truly comprehended only in its relationship to the others. 131. The first aspect of the system is obviously its specificity. Technologies are not comparable to anything else. 132. But we have to go further. All the parts are correlated, a correlation accentuated by the technicizing of information. 133. The consequences are twofold. First of all, one cannot modify a technology without causing repercussions and modifications in a huge number of other objects or methods. Secondly, the combinations of technologies produce technological effects, engendering new objects or new methods. And these combinations take place necessarily, inevitably. But beyond that, the technological world, like any system, has a certain tendency to regulate itself, that is to constitute an order of development and functioning which makes technology engender both its own accelerators and its own brakes. 134. This system exists basically not because a mechanical relationship has established itself between the different factors. By no means should we imagine the technological system like the different parts of a clockwork, but because we have a denser and denser ensemble of information relationships. 135. The more technology develops, the further the labors of information increase as a condition of that development. 136. Material output and the movements of physical objects have become less important than these non-material activities. The information explosion was necessary for the creation of the system. It is not a mere accidental product of our capacity to produce information. 137. It is in this context that we must ask about the new technological ensemble, thanks to which the technological system is completing the process of constituting itself. 138. The importance of the computer is obviously tied to the fact that the further we advance, the more significant a part of our world information becomes. This is already a platitude. We are no longer a society dominated by the imperative of production, now, we are ruled by the transmission, circulation, reception, and interpretation of multiple information. And that is exactly how the system is completing its constitution. 139. What makes it flexible and ungraspable at a given moment is that one can never draw up any sort of inventory of the system, because that would mean coagulating the information, hence negating the system itself. 140. The machine does not do everything. Man must first define the goal, the objective to be attained, on condition that it can be evaluated quantitatively, decide on a program to put into the machine's memory and translate the program into a language that the computer can understand, and gather the specific data of the problem to be solved. The machine performs the operations and presents the results, but it is man who decides what he will do with the results. The machine cannot, in theory, we will see the discussion below, surpass its own limits or take initiatives. It functions according to rules that are defined in advance. By using the computer, man, admittedly, can pass along inferior, automatic tasks, and it is inferred that he can therefore devote himself to the superior tasks of inventing, of conceiving programs. But we can stop here in this recollection of platitudes. 141. The translating machine? It exists and is being used. But we are told by Elgazi, Vacca, and even Moles that it is a complete flop. The machine furnishes translations that are perfectly unintelligible, just as the teaching machines or chess-playing machines are still in the realm of fancy. 142. As for demonstrating theorems, these theorems were all known. The computer has not advanced mathematics by even one jot. Regarding the possibility of having the computer learn autonomously and on the basis of its previous experience, it is, as Vacca says, a matter of definitions. One can program computers to react to signals from the outer world and to put those signals to their own use. The computer can work out statistics on the behavior of the surrounding milieu and, in terms of results, orient the apparatuses that are placed under its control. But there is no way that the computer can furnish an optimal reaction to events that were not foreseen by the programmer. 143. Elgazi can accurately say that the intrinsic feature of the human mind is not making calculations but knowing that it is making calculations and knowing what they signify. And this is something the computer will never achieve. 144. It is the computer that allows the technological system to definitively establish itself as a system. First of all, it is the computer that allows the large subsystems to organize. 145. The computer has everywhere the function of integrating the parts of the technological subsystems. 146. If one sets up a computer, and we have seen that this is nothing as yet, without first analyzing the system, one ultimately transfers the strategies and structures of the simplest possible system into the programs of the computer in order not to risk a large-scale failure. Thus, there are systems in which a certain number of processes are run by a computer and which, for that reason alone, are considered modern and efficient, whereas they actually offer highly modest and uninteresting benefits, says Elgazi. Using a computer is not enough to make us modern. 147. The computer is not a gadget to do things better and faster. Computers are the correlation factor in the technological system. Until now, the large technological ensembles have had few interrelations. 25 years ago, there was no way to speak of the technological system, because all that could be ascertained was a growth of technology is all areas of human activity. It was an anarchic growth, however, these areas were still kept specific by the traditional division of operations performed by man, and there was no relationship between them. People did look for the technological means to relate them, but they never managed to think of anything but an institutional type organization. 148. The further technicization advanced, the more the technological sectors tended to become independent, autonomous, and incoherent. Only the computer can deal with this. But it is quite obvious that it cannot be one computer. It has to be an ensemble of computers working interrelatedly at all communication points of the system. 149. The computer performs a task inaccessible to man. And thus, there is no rivalry between them. The ideology that sees the robot as a servant or rebel, or the computer as ultimately replacing man in the evolution of creatures, is a bunch of fancies proving that the people who talk about the computer haven't the foggiest notion of what a computer is, and approach it through anthropomorphism. It is not enough to say that the computer can do this or that. All this talk is nonsense. The sole function of the data processing ensemble is to allow a junction, a flexible, informal, purely technological, immediate, and universal junction of the technological subsystems. Hence, we have a new ensemble of new functions, from which man is excluded not by competition, but because no one has so far performed those functions. This does not, of course, imply that the computer eludes man, but rather, a strictly non-human ensemble is establishing itself. 150. The numerical universe of the computer is gradually becoming the universe that is regarded as the reality we are integrated in. If the instrument must be employed to its full capacity, then dialectical thinking becomes impossible. We have to admit that the computer is both Manichaean, repetitive, and non-comprehensive. 151. The computer has entered a perfectly oriented system. It will not, by itself, bring any democratizing or decentralizing. On the contrary, it will accentuate the opposite trends. 152. In practically all writings on technology, the authors wonder if we can change the use of the automobile, or if TV has a bad effect, etc. But this is meaningless. Because TV, for instance, exists only in terms of a technological universe, as an indispensable distraction for people living in this universe and as an expression of this universe. It is not raw or cultural per se because it quite simply does not exist in and of itself. It is TV plus all the rest of the technological actions. 153. Subsystems, rail, postal, telephone, and air systems, a production and distribution system for electric power, industrial processes of automated production, an urban system, a military defense system, etc. These subsystems were organized without long-term planning. They were organized, adapted, and modified step by step, in response to demands made by, for example, the growth in size of these subsystems and the gradually emerging relationships to the other subsystems. Sometimes, people have tried to thoroughly reorganize such an ensemble from square one. But, it must be noted, such attempts work less and less because each ensemble is now tied up with, and conditioned by the others. 154. Flexibility. What we have just said would make it appear enormously rigid, and indeed, the imperatives are more and more numerous and demanding. But it seems that while this may be true for each subsystem, the ensemble per se tends to function more flexibly, and the strength and stability of technology reside in that ability to adapt. 155. The technological system produces more and more efficient mechanisms to bring about conformity. It can offer a huge measure of independence so long as human action does not challenge the system. 156. He can listen to the music he likes, dress as he likes, take on completely aberrant religious beliefs or moral attitudes. None of these things challenge the technological system. The technologies even produce the means of these diversifications for man. But these diversifications exist only to the extent that the technologies function, and the latter function only to the extent that the technological system keeps improving. 157. It is a mistake made by many thinkers, like Charles Reich or Anonymous, to see increased liberty here or a challenge to the system by free behaviors or the emergence of a new phenomenon independent of technology. In reality, these motions of independence are strictly dependent. 158. Conformity to technology is now the true social conformity. 159. Regionalist theories all have the same function, to refine or justify the reductive dynamics of differences. Regionalism is a product of the technological society, despite the contrary appearances, which make technology out to be always centralizing. Technology can also be decentralizing so long as the decentralized factor is more strongly integrated into the system itself. In this way, regionalism can be an aspect of technocracy, although presenting itself as an application of liberalism. 160. Technology, which is neither wicked, visible, nor appalling, but utterly gentle and benign. 161. Crozier, in The Stalled Society, very accurately points out that, in order to cope with technological growth, there will have to be more invention, creation, nonconformity, and challenge. Creativity and nonconformity are fundamental values in the technological society. Indeed, for its progress, this society requires not passiveness but an enthusiastic approval of change. It is technology that demands an assault on the old values, on morals and traditional ethics. 162. The challenger opens the way for technological strides. Creativity is called upon, because whenever technology advances, forms of life that are possible in technology must be invented. 163. But it is wrong to believe that there is true creativity. This relates only to technology. True nonconformity, it expresses merely a conformity to the deeper and stronger reality. When I speak of conformism and Crozier of nonconformism, we are simply not on the same level of analysis. It is certain that by progressing non-stop, technology challenges the old structures and values, and incites man to create whatever allows him to live in this environment. But this is never anything but conformity, and creativity will produce the countless gadgets. Those bell-bottoms so dear to the heart of Charles Reich are an essential product of this adaptable creativity. 164. Likewise, an altruistic ideology will see the light of day, neo-Christianism for others, or the ideology of socialism with a human face. The more truly oppressive the system gets, the more man has to compensate by affirming his independence. The more destructive the system gets towards human relations, the more man has to aver himself an altruist, which Baudrillard is perfectly correct in labeling a social lubrication. Once this altruism leaves the verbal and institutionalized domain, it will itself become very quickly technicized. One should not view the technological system as manufacturing human robots. On the contrary, it develops those things on which we make our humanity most strongly dependent: diversity, altruism, nonconformity. But they are perfectly integrated into the system itself. 165. I always come back to the example of the Nazi soldier, at the start of the war. He was trained for individual initiative, for non-servility toward commanders, for the capacity to take over an enterprise himself, and he therefore seemed the opposite of the mechanized soldier, who is at his sergeant's beck and call. But this freedom existed only within the army. He was not free to desert. It was meant to turn out better fighters, within the Nazi ideology, and it was achieved by extreme psychological manipulation. Such is the creativity, the nonconformity of man inside the technological society. 166. The mathematician Cournot, who, in his Considerations sur la marche des et des venements dans les temps modernes, 1872, was probably the first to understand and expose the vast danger of not only mechanization but technology as well. A good deal later, Adams, The Degradation of Democratic Dogma, 1919, saw the consequences of technology with an extreme lucidity. The voices of these scientists were muffled by the existence of the pressure group of technicians and scientists, which Galbraith clarified in The New Industrial State. The group of technicians is perfectly integrated into the technological system and acts as a relay between technology and society. 167. The one, the it, the field, all Lacanism, etc. is purely and simply Majorism, just as incidentally, the style of Lacan, and of so many other writers, is very significantly sheer incantation. It is a mechanical expression of the compensatory reaction by the technological system. 168. Technology is a flexible ensemble that tends to endlessly reproduce its own reorganization. Otherwise, it would not be technology. A bit like a doll with a lead bass, you can push it down and rock it, but it always regains its balance, though in a different place from before. 169. Thus, technology contains within itself its own processes of reorganization, for it is precisely a technological organization. 170. Any challenge to, any disturbance in the system is nothing but a provocation, a solicitation to have new technologies, new organizations, new procedures established, each time integrating a larger amount of data, its quantity unlimited thanks to the computer. And this does not take place against man or to control or dominate him. The system has no intention and no objective. It merely rolls along. And its servants are quite convinced that they are working for the good of man. They are inspired by the best intentions. 171. Absence of feedback. Now the technological system does not tend to modify itself when it develops nuisances or obstructions, etc. This system is given to pure growth, hence it causes the increase of irrationalities. Also, it is clumsy and lacks fluidity. When disorders and irrationalities are noted, they bring nothing but compensatory processes. The system continues to develop along its own line. 172. We find such a model in the traditional societies with, for instance, the view of the world accepted by all members of that society, its religion, its Weltanschauung, its traditional laws, etc. But the technological system does not have such a system because of its absolute domination over the environment. It evolves by its own logic, totalitarian character of the system, the indefinite complexification, the reconstitution of the destroyed human environment, the search for the quality of life, the tendency toward dislocation caused by the disappearance of qualitative controls, the reckoning of costs, the external economic costs, the denaturalization of man with the disappearance of natural rhythms, of spontaneity, of creativity, the incapacity for moral judgment because of power. Those are insoluble problems, because, in order to deal with them, it is not enough to overcome drawbacks, to remove a present-day difficulty, to find a way of counteracting a danger. We would have to be able to go back to the source of the technological process to modify the totality of the functioning and the organization. 173. The entire technological drama at the moment is heading toward a situation in which technology, having conquered its autonomy and functioning by self-augmentation, could not, on the contrary, have feedback except by outer pressure. Feedback is made possible by the data processing complex, but the relationship has to be mediated by a non-technological element which runs counter to autonomy and is perfectly unacceptable. 174. The technological system itself, but to the fact that it functions only by intro information, data on itself, and never by extro information. Thus, the true problems are on the inside of the system. 175. Habermas, Technik und Wissenschaft tools ideology, who confuses technology, French, technique, and technological discourse, and whose idea of what he means by technique strikes me as totally dated. L'Admiral's preface to that book says, technologies or technological rules are applications of empirical knowledge formalized by the experimental sciences. They put technological means to work on any material object capable of being reutilized systematically within the framework of certain sequences of instrumental activity. A simplistic definition, applicable perhaps to 19th century technology but having nothing to do with the present day phenomenon. Autonomy. 176. One may speak of an interdependence between technology and its environment, but it is nevertheless technology that now dominates its environment. 177. An autonomous technology. This means that technology ultimately depends only on itself, it maps its own route, it is a prime and not a secondary factor, it must be regarded as an organism tending toward closure and self-determination, it is an end in itself. Autonomy is the very condition of technological development. This autonomy corresponds precisely to what J. Baudrillard, Le Système d'Objet, sees under the name of functionality when he says that 178, functional qualifies not what is adapted to an end but rather what is adapted to an order or a system. 179. Even if the sciences did not advance for a certain time, the progress of the technological object towards specificity could continue. 180. The essential element is not the decision by politicians to use a scientific discovery in a certain way, but rather, the necessary implication of all scientific research in technology is the determining factor. It is the domination of the technological aspect over the epistemic aspect. 181. Technology is both ahead of and behind science, and it is also at the very heart of science. The latter projects itself into technology and is absorbed into it, and technology is formulated in scientific theory. 182. All science, having become experimental, depends on technology, which alone permits reproducing phenomena technologically. Now, technology abstractly reproduces nature to permit scientific experimenting. Hence, the temptation to make nature conform to theoretical models, to reduce nature to techno-scientific artificiality. Nature is what I produce in my laboratory, says a modern physicist. 183. In these conditions, science becomes violence, in regard to everything it bears upon, and the technology expressing the scientific violence becomes power exclusively. Thus, we have a new correlation, which I consider fundamental, between science and technology. The scientific method itself determines technology's calling to be a technology of power. And technology, by the means it makes available to science, induces science into the process of violence, against the ecology, for instance. The power of technology, theoretically unlimited, but impossible to utilize effectively, materializes in a technology of power. That is the ultimate point of this relationship, which the text summed up here calls the technological baroque. 184. The state decides, technology obeys. And even more, that is how it must be, it is the true recourse against technology. 185. The more informed the citizen, the less he can participate, because the evaluations are perfectly contradictory. 186. It is, incidentally, once more the state that can assure technology its true place and its progress, because they maintain the giantism of economic ventures. 187. That marvelous ideal organism, the incarnation of truth and justice, letting a sweet equality reign without suppression or repression, favoring the weak in order to equalize opportunities, representing the general interest without damaging private interests, promoting liberty for all by a happy harmony, insensitive to the pressures and struggles of interest, patient but not paternalistic, liberating while socialistic, administering without creating a bureaucracy, able to encourage new activities of regulation and concertedness without claiming to impose its law, in such a way as to allow the social actors to freely control the effects of technological progress. A state, finally, having omnipotence, omniscience, without abusing them for anything in the world. 188. One can only pinch oneself before such a pastoral. Has anyone ever laid eyes on such a state? And if not, what guarantee, what chance do we have that it will come true? Who are the people who will starve it? Saints and martyrs? The huge, the enormous mistake of all those excellent authors is simply that they never breathe the word about this mythical state, which they entrust with so many functions. 189. The marvelous state that will run technology and solve the problems is composed of men. Why should they no longer be dominated by the spirit of power and structures, which are more and more technological? 190. What does power to the workers mean, black power, women's power, or that of the young, if not that their power is to replace the power in office? Such power is, at best, that of better managing growth, which is thereby enabled to pursue its glorious course thanks to these providential takeovers of power. School, whether teaching Marxism or fascism, reproduces a pyramid of classes of failures. The airplane, even if made accessible to the worker, reproduces a social hierarchy with a superior class. I heartily go along with these ideas. 191. When the state makes purely political decisions, it is the politician alone who decides, and this always causes disasters on the technological level. 192. Most of the non-technicized countries must either leave their riches unexploited or else appeal to highly technicized countries, whatever their ideological outlook may be. 193. Ideological imperialism is nonsense. Only the technological weight gives true superiority. 194. Technology develops on the basis of a certain number of possibilities offered by the economy. And when the economic resources are lacking, technology cannot operate at its full capacity, achieving what its possibilities allow it to achieve. 195. The relationship between technology and economy is complex. Technology is a determining factor in economic growth, but the converse is equally true. Clausewitz shows clearly that the impact of technology on economy is ambiguous and that economic advances are not proportionately highest where there is the most technological research. 196. There is no denying that the evolution of technologies can be understood only if placed in its original historical context. But it is all right to think that the original task of the historian of technologies consists precisely in revealing the intrinsic logic of the evolution of technologies. This evolution actually takes place with an internal logic, which is a very distinct phenomenon from the logic in the evolution of socio-economic history. Investigating this internal logic in the technological evolution is the only way for the technological history of the technologies to slough off its character of data history. 197. Technological invention comes to depend also on possibilities of economic investment. We thus perceive a mutual influence. On the one side, all modern economic growth depends on technological application, in all areas. But vice versa, the possibilities of advanced technological research and of the application of technologies depend both on the economic infrastructure and on possibilities of mobilizing economic resources. 198. Negatively, the economy can thus either block technological development for lack of power or prevent technological application. 199. Economy can be a means of development, a condition for technological progress, or, inversely, it can be an obstacle, but never does it determine, provoke, or dominate that progress. 200. Like political authority, an economic system that challenges the technological imperative is doomed. 201. It is not economic law that imposes itself on the technological phenomenon, it is the law of technology which orders and ordains, orients and modifies the economy. It is hard for the Marxists to admit that technology has become an autonomous factor, dominating the economic structure and having the same nature and effects in both a capitalist and a communist regime. 202. Man in his hubris above all intellectuals still believes that his mind controls technology, that he can impose any value, any meaning upon it. And the philosophers are in the forefront of this vanity. 203. Technology does not progress in terms of a moral ideal, it does not seek to realize values, it does not aim at a virtue or a good. 204. Technology does not endure any moral judgment. The technician does not tolerate any insertion of morality in his work. 205. The technician who puts something to work claims to be as free as the scientist who does the research. Thus it is childish of an intellectual to bring morality into the consequences if he has rejected it in the principle. 206. An absolutely engrossing study was done by an American technologist on the following theme: so long as the problems are purely technological, they can always find a clear and certain solution. But once the human factor has to enter, or once these problems become too large for any direct technological handling, they seem insoluble. 207. Social engineering. This innovation appeals to the better feelings. A whole improvement of man rests on the finer instincts, and it claims that the root will be the improvement of man, albeit obtained by technologies, psychological or psychosociological technologies. 208. Man does what technology allows him to do. He has thus undertaken to do anything. Maintaining that morality should not judge invention or technological operation leads to saying, unwittingly, that any human action is now beyond ethics. 209. The autonomy of technology thus renders us immoral. 210. Since technology does not support any ethical judgment, we come to the third aspect of its autonomy. It does not tolerate being halted for a moral reason. 211. The power and autonomy of technology are so well assured that now technology